Yeah, UNC is CEO.
Thank you for inviting us and interesting meeting. We are interested in community organization and every country, Japanese and Japan and American, Chinatown. I've been in the Chinatown and yesterday. We have a late dinner. Yeah. And just in the Manhattan. Another Chinatown in the Russian. I wanted to be Russian and eat. Yeah, eat and wonderful dinner. Yeah. okay. We ran the, between and Chinese American and Japanese and in the community level. We get started in the research program in terms of community organization and social planning for social welfare in the local level or local government. In America, in the famous history, America has a famous history in about in the citizen participation. We were learned how to participate in the administration in the city. Please and teach us and everything about the community. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much. I think that it would really be a very interesting learning experience for us as well as for our visitors. I just hope that next time you visit, you will stay longer, and so that we can really sit down and pick our brains up. Before I go on to introduce the other two professors, I just want to mention that Professor Betty Lee Song, our chairperson of our institute, is joining us. And would you like to welcome the three professors, Professor Song?
I better not. Tell them I just had eye surgery.
Okay. All right. So this institute is a very young institute. It was established only about 3 years ago. And Professor Betty Lee Song is one of the most die-hard supporter and leader of that to make it possible. So, but she just had an eye surgery, so she'd like to welcome everybody, but she's not going to be speaking. So the next speaker will be Professor Waki, Associate Professor at Meiji Gakuin University. Please forgive me if I pronounce it wrong. And he's going to be talking to us about his experience and his projection for the future. Please come here, Professor Waki.
Okay, thank you for the introduction of myself. I started to introduce myself to you. And my name is Wake, W-A-K-E, and you are familiar with the name, Mr. Wake. Some of my friends call me Mr. Wake. Yes, and when I arrived at Chicago a couple of years ago, and the officer called me Mr. Wake. So I don't understand what's name, who? Is Miss Awake. Anyway, I'm an associate professor of Meiji Gakuin University, and my university is located at the downtown of Tokyo, and we have a long history, and my university is was established over 150 years ago, one of the oldest universities in Japan. So I belong to the Department of Sociology. Department of Sociology has two courses. One is sociology, and one is the other one, and the other is social work and social welfare. So I'm a teacher of the social work and social welfare course. So anyway, my major, my specialization is social welfare planning and social work research. I have had very good experience for one this week for the field work. We have a good, I have a good experience of the field work in New York. So I'm so very glad to it's my great honor to invite here and to speak a short briefing on myself. The project will be developed by the other professors, especially Professor Maki Sato is a leader of the project, and he will develop this project and expand the territory of our research, including Asian studies in New York. Is that right? Okay, he said yes. So anyway, I enjoyed and well this time, this year. Yeah, thank you so much.
Yeah. Your final work will be written in Japanese, right?
In Japanese. So I have some articles written in English. Yes. If you want it, then please send me an email. I will attach my file to you. Okay? Okay, anyway, thank you for thank you very much.
I would also like to welcome Professor Joyce Gelb, who has done research in Japan. And I'm glad that she's joining us.
I'm sorry I'm so late. Please forgive me. I did not intend to be so late. Good evening to all.
Okay. And the next speaker will be Professor Takegawa, Associate Professor at Tokyo University, and also at the Graduate School of Social Science. Please welcome Professor Takegawa.
Thank you very much. My name is Shogo Takegawa. Some people confuse my name with Shogun, but I'm not Shogun, just Shogo. And so I am an associate professor of sociology at Tokyo University. Tokyo University is, of course, located in Tokyo. The campus is center of Tokyo city. So this is the first time to visit the United States. Many people advise me to visit this place, that place, that place, that place. But our stay is very limited. As professor said, tomorrow morning I will have to leave. Why I wanted to come to New York is a sociologist said New York, London, and Tokyo is a world city. I'm very familiar with Tokyo, and I've been to London many times, but I have never been to New York until now. So I think this is a good chance for me to know the New York City. This time, the time is very limited. When I came next time, I would like to walk from the north to south by Broadway. So maybe next year or 2 years later, or I'm not sure, but I'd like to walk from Broadway and from the north to the south. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Takegawa. This institute is, as I said, started only 3 years ago. It has an extremely small budget, but it's very, very ambitious. Not only do we want to study about the Asian American community within New York City, we also think that we can't really study the Asian American community here without understanding what is going on in Asia. And that is why we introduced the concept of, say, we must reach out to Asia and to find out what is going on there. And I'm very, very happy that the three professors are visiting us. This is almost Christmas time. We have three scholars coming to visit us with a bright light. I'm very happy. I hope that this is a good sign for the future. And as we talk about exchanges, I'm very happy that Professor Gelb is joining us, and I hope that maybe Professor Gelb, who has also done some research in Japan, you want to say a few words, maybe?
Thank you.
Please.
Okay. Well, good evening, everybody. Again, forgive me for being late. It's a busy and rainy time of year. I was the recipient of a grant from the Institute, and so I did go over to Japan. I've been to Japan many times very grateful for the support that I got from the Institute, so that's one reason I wanted to be here this evening. Another reason I wanted to be here this evening is to welcome our Japanese colleagues, as I have been welcomed so often in Japan. I was a todai, I was a visiting scholar, I was a doshisha. I have really been very fortunate to have wonderful colleagues and friends in Tokyo and Kyoto, Sapporo most recently, and I'm really very grateful for that, and for the opportunity actually that City College afforded me initially. I should put in a plug. As a scholar in 1987, I first went as an exchange scholar to Toritsu Daigaku, where we did have a sister relationship, and that began my interest in researching Japan. So I just wanted to again express my appreciation and welcome to our visitors and to wish everybody a happy holiday season. Thank you.
So as we begin to say learn from one another, the Asian American Asian Research Institute has done quite a bit of work in terms of, say, the study of especially the Chinatown area in New York City. And we've held 11 sessions workshop, and we have published that in the proceeding. And if any of you who are interested in what some of the experts talked about Chinatown in New York City, please feel free to pick up one of these when you go out. And as we are talking about Chinatown, there is no better scholar, with the exception of Professor Betty Lee Song here, that can address the Chinese Americans, somebody who has done a lot of research for the past 20 years and has written profusely about the development of Chinatown. And this is Professor Peter Kwong, who is going to be talking to us about a new profile of Chinatown. And please welcome Professor Peter Kwong from Hunter College and the Graduate School.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned Betty as the foremost authority on this subject. Actually, my topic is not about Chinatown. My topic is much more ambitious. I'm moving out. I'm actually going to talk a little bit about what I've been working. The last couple of years, everybody's complaining I'm not around, I can't be found. I'm writing. I'm writing this book with my wife. It's basically on Chinese Americans, the whole history from the beginning to now, everything you want to know. And this is a subject matter that a publisher asked me to do 11 years ago, and I started it, and I said, you know, I can't do this. This is too complicated, too difficult. In the meantime, I wrote several other books, and then 3 or 4 years ago, somebody called me and says, you know, we want to do a pictorial book on on Chinese Americans. And I said, no. My wife says, why not? So I said, well, if you want to do the work. So in the process, I realized, after all, I got to face the music and write this book on Chinese Americans. And let me tell you, it's been tough. It's been really tough. Tough is not about the amount of work. Tough is about the fact that's why we need this research center, that Chinese American studies, Asian American studies, is really, really underdeveloped. All the areas, you know, most writers assume that you go in and copy from everybody and you have a book. And everything you look, every aspect from the beginning of history, there's big holes, big contradictions. And so doing this is almost like I'm trying to correct all the problems that we have had as a field. And the part of the problem is we're not getting enough support. We're not training enough historians, social scientists. We have trained a lot of literature people, but the things that really fundamental, important about Chinese Americans, we have not had very good quality research. Now, every time somebody asks you, what are you doing? I said, I'm writing a book on Chinese Americans. And people just turn away and start it on some other topic. The reason is very simple. Anybody wants to deal with a minority group, people will believe either you're trying to talk about the sufferings and that you have gone through and asking for affirmative action, asking for redress. Or you're writing a book to celebrate about the success, how hard the Chinese suffer, and now we are successful. All right? And so that has been the mold. And so if you talk about Chinese Americans, first of all, Chinese Americans, whereas we had a difficult history, never suffer as badly as African Americans, right? That's objective. On the other hand, the kind of suffering we're going through is not, many people would argue, is not that different from the Europeans. European immigrants came here, as you hear all the story about Lo Yi San and all that stuff, or they have suffered discrimination and all that kind of stuff. But they have suffered through and made it. So whatever problems the Chinese Americans are complaining about is a matter of paying the dues, so to speak, to become part of America. So there's nothing much to talk about. If I want to pursue more, people would say, you know, by the way, my cousin just married a nice Chinese girl. Or my other relatives just adopted a Chinese girl from mainland China. So the point here is that we are trapped in many ways. Right. A discourse is either assimilation of the European models or the models African Americans. Now, Asian American studies in the meantime is caught in this bind. It's basically refused to accept that somehow something is different. The Asian American studies rooted, started out from the whole perspective very similar to the African-American experience, the whole emphasis on racism, discrimination, all that stuff. And so the other side, the European would say, hey, look, you know, you guys have made it, all right? And Asian-American studies says, well, no, we have not. And they will point out all the reasons we have not, all right? Now, I don't want to get involved in this discussion because this is a discussion that is getting nowhere. because we are really trying to argue an issue 20, 30 years ago. One side says, America is not racist, anybody who works hard could make it. The other side, it's racist, you can't make it, all right? So the end result is whether you make it or not in the society. But that's not the main point. The main point here seems to me that we're missing all kinds of subtle details about America, all right? About so many things you would say Chinese-American experience is not the European experience, all right? It's very different. Chinese-American experience is not the same as African-American experience, all right? So, but much more so that there are a lot of issues that we have been focusing on race, for instance. Chinese-American has issue of class, issue of nationality, issue of all other types of stuff that has never been seriously grouped together to discuss. In any event, that's my challenge, trying to break out of this trap. Try to break out a trap from the American society is also trying to break out the Asian American studies. Right? That somehow there's a certain political correct things you can't say we have made it. You know, you got to say yes, but however, right? You all familiar with this. So I thought today, I mean, I could go on and on talk about starting from the beginning of 19th century and all that, but let me just talk a little bit about the last 20 years. And as you probably know, I'm known for Chinese Americans, working class Chinese Americans. And however, my background is not Chinese Americans, Chinatown Americans. I'm sorry. I'm well known for Chinese American working class. Well known for being Chinatown. So we're dealing with a lot of working class issues. Now, personally, I'm not. I would classify myself, quote unquote, the term uptown Chinese. And I have not been really worked very carefully, written very much on this issue, but in recently, I realized that there is something very, very important happening. In the last 20 years, both so-called working class Chinese Americans as well as professional Chinese Americans have gone through tremendous transformation. Still bipolar. We're still talking about population one end, working class, in the enclaves, and some of the working class conditions much worse than the 1980s, today you talk about the illegal immigrants from Fujian, you talk about sweatshop, it's almost a daily complaints about sweatshops. That is one side, and the number of this population is also increasing. A lot of them coming, continue to come, working class background. And now, the condition of those people, though, you have a problem. Increasing number of working class immigrants. Shrinking traditional markets. When we talk about markets in ethnic enclave, we're talking about garment, we're talking about restaurant. All right? Those are two industries are not doing well, particularly the garment. Garment, as you know, the international competition, et cetera, et cetera. And the lack of reinvestment into the garment industry. So the garment jobs are shrinking, and the profits are increasing, declining. The result of is the employers trying to squeeze more, and that's why you have the sweatshop conditions. Now, the labor market is shrinking, but there's another aspect. Space is shrinking. When you talk about Chinatown, right? Manhattan Chinatown, we're talking in the old days six blocks, now it's go all the way to Delancey Street. And this is going on everywhere else. So in other words, you have a traditional Chinese community, increasing immigrants coming in, and the real estate value goes up, and then you develop new Chinatowns. And now you have in Sunset Park, you have Queens, and Sunset Park, I don't know whether you're familiar with, Sunset Park a few years ago was a reasonable place. Now if you want to buy a house in Sunset Park, it's $450,000. Now, if you're working class, what do? That's no longer your space either. So you're moving out to Avenue U. After a few years, Avenue U. So here you have a situation, it's very, very interesting. In all the years we talk about Chinatowns, we see it as enclosed. Right? But the objective economic circumstances is forcing these people to go farther and farther out, as well as farther and farther into jobs previously they're not familiar with. Right? So, more and more people are going to construction, more and more people are going to all kinds of things. You're familiar, I mean, Chinese buses, right? I mean, we're not just minibuses, we're going to these buses to go to all these different cities, right? So, Chinese working class are constantly trying to push out to find jobs. And one of the liabilities is language. If you're stuck in Chinatown, you don't learn English, it's very difficult for you to break out. But the fact of the matter is forcing them to break out and forcing them to look for new opportunities, and to a point, we are seeing diversity of the kind of jobs working class Chinese are moving into now. For instance, you work in Chinatown, sweatshop, $3.75 an hour. You probably have to work 90 hours a week. You go to Marriott Hotel, $10 an hour, 40-hour week, overtime, overpay. All right? Well, you say, why would you go? In the past, nobody is helping you to do that. You don't know the language, nobody helped you, and Marriott is not interested. Now, these things are happening. Nursing. A lot of Chinese Americans are now getting into home nursing. Right? Some of them are working for Chinese, some of them not working for Chinese. So, in a very interesting way, Chinese working class are breaking out of this kind of concentration, which is both culturally and linguistically very constraining. Now, there's also another options, which is, I don't know how many of you live in the suburbs. How many? Just you? Well, this is not a very typical group of Chinese Americans. Do you realize there are more Chinese Americans nationwide living in the suburbs than the whites? Now, that statistic is significant. It's significant in many, many ways. The number of uptown Chinese are increasing dramatically, living in the suburbs. All right? Now, these people live in the suburbs, they are not American born. Some of them are, but a lot of them are not American born. And they have still kind of attachment relationship to Chinese, whatever services, etc. Now, the new kind of job today is also aiming at serving suburban Chinese community. Right. Now, you know, there are all these, well, I'll just give you one example. You go to New Jersey, you go to California, you could even go to Westchester. Increasingly, there are services provided, bilingual services provided for uptown Chinese. All right, you have supermarkets. One of them is in there's about 800 Chinese supermarkets, various different chains. They are located outside of urban centers. They are located in the suburbs. Right now, there's one in Princeton. A friend of mine says, you know, we have this Oriental. He used the word Oriental store in Princeton. This is wonderful, fantastic. I don't know what ethnicity is. I said, I'm coming. I went. It's a huge, huge supermarket called Asian food market, right. And it's huge. It's clean. It's neat. It's got lines of food. I mean, 10 different kind of eggplants, 20 different kind of sauces, everything you want to know. But I have yet to establish whether it's Chinese owned or not. Then I found there's a fresh fish tank. There's all these ducks and barbecue, right? It's got to be Chinese, right? sure enough, it is Chinese. But more important, the fact there is fresh fish, somebody has to cut it. It's not going to be some PhD Chinese Americans going to skin or whatever the proper word for the fish, right? It's going to be some working class individual that you butcher. So my question is, where do they live? Princeton, an hour, 20 minutes, an hour and a half. There are many, many Chinese restaurants too. Where do they live? Well, the conventional answer is, oh, you know, you go to Chinatown in the morning, there's these vans going up. That's true. There's also the traditional understanding that some of the restaurant owners will rent a big house and let them. But it's also true now, some of the Chinese working class are moving to the suburbs, in the lesser suburbs. Right? Some of the Edison is one of them. So working class Hispanic, working class blacks who are servicing suburban upper middle class clients, they are there. So this is going on. In fact, some of the I would tell you, the thing that's most amazing about that supermarket is this. So I found all these things happening. I walk out of the supermarket. Just before I walk out, there's a whole stack of free papers. You've seen them, right? Chinese language paper. Five different varieties. One is from Taiwan, you know, it's complicated characters. Two from mainland China because it's simplified language. One is from Falun Gong. One is from a church, right? Another one is Stowaway. It's one of those web papers. And you look at them, I said, well, you know, these papers, what can they be? They must be published from New York City, right? I brought them home, I look at them. It's not from New York City. It's local published for the New Jersey, Philadelphia regions. And you open up the things, you know, they have the same kind of stories. But the most important thing is advertising, all right? Plumber, Route 26, exit so-and-so. Chinese rugs, Chinese restaurants, of course, all right? Chinese masseuse, Chinese herbal. Everything that is, almost everything, that exists in Chinatown is now readily available in dispersed space of New Jersey suburbs, right? And you can see this in New Jersey, but California is even more so. So you are seeing, right, a very interesting phenomena of suburbanization. Suburbanization of upper, middle class, professionals, as well as slowly Chinese working class. Okay, now I'm going to talk about the uptown Chinese. Everybody knows, since 1952, since the change of immigration law, at that time, that allowing, encouraging, in fact, people who are professional skills to come, Chinese have been coming to the United States. I mean, even before that, with the stranded scholars from mainland China, but the first law that really changed that was 1952 law. It basically says that the people with professional skill required in the United States, we will... Now, those were the days, a racist days, all right? Everything about the... But on this particular provision, it did not specify nationality or race, all right? And that was when I was young, I remember. My mother would say, so-and-so, all right, is now in the United States going to school and going to Harvard or something, all right? Someday I hope you do that. Or, you know, maybe you're not good enough to go to do that. Anyway, that's the way. Okay. Now, so, the law initially was hoping to get European to come to the United States. But they didn't come, all right? The quota was never filled. So what did they do? Drafted foreign students. One of the biggest, well, the biggest foreign students group is from Taiwan. So therefore you have these Taiwan students. And then mainland China. So in other words, there's a whole generation of scientists engineers, doctors have come to the United States. You all know that, all right? And they are they move very fast. They come here to go to graduate school. After 4 years, they get your PhD. Then the training, they get a job, and then a few years later, they get married, have kids, and then they decide they have to move to the suburbs for the kids. And then by that time, the kids is a pain in the neck, so you have to invite your grandparents to come. So this is the typical thing, right? Now, this is what everybody talks about the Chinese Americans or Asian Americans. They are model minorities. They come to this country in a few years, they're able to up with mobile, right? So this has been the you know, economic statistics shows how different and all that. Now, when you ask, however, uptown Chinese, particularly those people who work for IBM or Westinghouse, by the way, IBM is practically non-existent. I'm still talking about the older days. One of the things that I interview all these years, the older generation, the one uniform thing is glass ceiling. Right? Can't get promoted. I've been working here. I'm better educated than that white guy come in and move up. Right? This has been this narrative. So the number of uptown Chinese have increased, first from Taiwan, from Hong Kong, then from Chinese, from mainland China. Now, I would like to submit to you, in the last 15 years, some of this narrative is changing. Yes, glass ceiling continue to exist. I would consider myself a victim of glass ceiling. I don't know which glass it is, but anyway. So, but there's something new happening. That's something new is that if you look at the census figure, 1990, the Chinese American median family income is 17% above whites. Okay? 2000, Chinese American family median income is 25%. Above whites. Something's going on. Okay? Working class Chinese are not going to help this statistic. Something is happening with the uptown Chinese.
Right.
Well, so what is that thing? Well, I'm trying to submit to you there's something very, very important happening. In the professional Chinese, there is a process of diversification and improved mobility. Now, how do I explain it? 1990, United States had made a whole series of change in immigration law. And the change of immigration law is basically saying, you know, we have too many immigrants coming in, particular kind of immigrants that we don't like, which is basically relatives of working class immigrants. So 1990, what they did was trying to not reduce the number of family unit quota, but dramatically increase the number of professionals, right, by four times. So in other words, it was 50,000 per year, turned out to be 200,000 per year. Secondly, in that change of quota, there is a fourth provision that classify people with money could come to the United States. If you have $1 million and willing to hire 10 people, create 10 jobs, you could get this visas. You have other visas, which is basically transfer of professionals from one company to another. If IBM has a company, a subsidiary in China, the IBM could automatically switch somebody to the United States without having to go through all that labor process. Then you have the dramatic increase of H-1 visa. You probably know H-1B visa, which is basically Microsoft complaining we don't have enough computer experts. So that number also increased to something like 200,000 per year. So if you look at this pattern, right, there is a dramatic switch in terms of favoring professional skilled people to come to the United States. And that number is reflected, okay, in as well as the income is reflected in the statistics. Now, I want to say something much more important. That is, the scientists, engineers that work in the United States today are quite different from the scientists working in the American scientific community 20 years ago. Why? Because decentralization, restructuring. One of the most important part of restructuring, you know, everybody talks about restructuring, move production away to somewhere else. But one of the most important development of restructuring was moving the research division outside of corporate headquarters. So in other words, IBM used to have their research. Bell Lab have their research. Everybody remembers, you know, Westinghouse, Bell Lab, they have a huge, and that's where Chinese, a lot of Chinese work. Okay, where's Bell Lab now? All right, so the research today is no longer done on premise because they're not producing anything. So what happened is that research is privatized. Silicon Valley is basically, you're talking about privatized research base. Right? A bunch of guys said, you know, let's open up a company and get a bid from whoever is willing to give us a bid. And so what happened is a lot of the very, very best computer scientists, they are not working for corporations. They're working for these small privatized companies. So Silicon Valley, you know, you go to Seattle, you have that complex, you go to Boston, you go to... So what happened is they are moving off from fixed corporate jobs into these jobs, which at one time highly paid, at the same time very, very highly risky. Right. Now, so also we also realize IBM or all these companies, I guess I'm a little bit older because I buy old computers, you know, always worrying about servicing, right? In the old days, you buy a computer, your company servicing it, right? Today, nobody services you. You're going to look for somebody. So this opens up, this is one example, open up all kinds of privatized, decentralized jobs, all right? So, Downtown Community TV, I'm on board of directors. We have this we purchased all those computer hardware for productions. Who the hell is going to manage this thing? How do you know this thing hooks up to that? How do you know if you want to have a close shot, what runs what? So, pretty much we have to get consultants. And who works for these consultants? A lot of the immigrant scientists. My computer repair person is Chinese, right? Many of you probably buy your computer through a Chinese distributor in Chinatown or in Sunset Park. These are the things that previously Chinese are not involved in, scientists. Right? So previously we're scientists. Today, in many of these, demanding not only scientists, you have to be entrepreneurial, you have to deal with marketing, you have to deal with budget, you probably have to hire some people. Right? So this is what I'm talking about, the diversification of the kind of jobs, the kind of roles people pay. Now, if you own your little computer company, the whole question of glass ceiling is a different story. Right? So, now, Chinese play a very, very important role in today's high-tech development. As you probably know, Silicon Valley, 25% of the owners of these research establishments are Chinese and Indian owned. And I think it's about 17% of the profits from the Silicon Valley, this is 1999 statistics, come from Chinese companies and hiring thousands of Chinese. So, in other words, this is a new venue, a little bit different from the old kind of stick-in corporate headquarters kind of job. Now, there's something else happening. And that gets into the whole question about the transnational aspect. Now, let's say you work for a company, you are a research company, and IBM says, Macintosh says, I want you to develop a G4 computer for me. Right? I think some of you have G4, right? And the people at the company, at that particular company in California, will develop this G4. When this thing G4 research develop, what's the next question Apple computers are going to ask? Where to make it, right? And usually they're going to ask that engineer, says, hey, you're from Taiwan. Can we make it in Taiwan? Yes. All my old school classmates are still there, right? And, let's work. So, incidentally, 40 to 50% of computer now is made in Taiwan. So what's going on here is this. The Chinese American scientists is playing the role of scientific developer, also agent to help, sometimes subcontractors. They will work with their buddies, say, hey, look, you set up a factory, I try to work with IBM, and this is where the transnational situation happens. Now, and today, for instance, as you can probably know, that Taiwan is developing its own Silicon Valley, accompanying the American developments. This is why Taiwan is so powerful. Not only that, Taiwan now is, as many of these people say, let's do in mainland China. Silicon Valley, the representation of Chinese from mainland China is also increasing. So what we're seeing, therefore, is a transnational economic technological exchange, interchange. And the scientists that we used to look for, who graduate from IBM, right, now is probably needed MBA degree. And many people involved in this have to have other skills, right? And also dealing with all kinds of international. So what I'm trying to, I don't have too much time to deal with all the details of this, but it is one of the very, very important components that's going on. Chinese Americans, along with overseas Chinese, has played the major role in American market penetration to Asia. Not only Taiwan, not only mainland China, they hook up with the Vietnamese, Chinese, set up these facilities. So, in this sense then, Chinese play a very important role in bridging this economic system, right, which is basically driven by United States. Okay. And Chinese Americans play many other roles. One of the roles is, everybody knows, if you want to do things, you need guanxi. Right? So, if you want to talk to a Chinese government about something, you have to know somebody. Who knows somebody? Well, Chinese Americans. Right? One of our family friends who I know, his father was number two man in KMT establishment. And he passed away. He had five kids, two in mainland China, two left in Taiwan, and this son is in the United States. And so 1972, Nixon went to China. The first thing the Chinese was interested is Boeing. And this person happens to be working for Boeing. All right? Now, it's highly, highly ironic. Here it is, the enemy of Communist China in the 1940s, and he is the honor guest because, you know, your father, we welcome you. So he was the one instrumental to start all those businesses, a Boeing company. I mean, everybody, you know, I talked to a Boeing company a few years back, they all say, Matthew Chen. Matthew Chen made our connection. This is the most important. Now, Matthew Chen is just one, many, many other. So, anyway, so this is, I'm trying to give an exposure of, we are no longer talking about the kind of issues that we used to talk about. The economic, political roles the Chinese Americans play in this context, right, is changing. Now, but not without liability. I'm going to try to fast concluding this thing so we have more discussions. That is, it's one thing for United States wanting to be able to invest in China, develop China, and all those things. We're the ones actually push investment and now they are producing all the things we need, all the things we want, right? Now, but part of this is possible is because various Chinese Americans, overseas Chinese Americans, play an important role to help expanding this development. But there's other side of this issue. The other side of the issue is China is getting bigger, more powerful. We can't trust them. So you have the two sides. On one side, you want these people to be as close to the top leader as possible, right? On the other side, says, how come you're so close to these people? You must be a spy. Right? So this is the predicament that we are in a very strange way. The two things happening all the time. Right? Wen Ho Lee, right? I don't know how much you know about Wen Ho Lee. Wen Ho Lee is probably one of the most unimaginative scientists in terms of, you know, I know of. He's just basically an old type of scientist. Had I stayed in engineering, I'd be just like Wen Ho Lee. He never reads newspapers. He does. I mean, he's not interested in any of these things. All right? But Los Alamos Lab says, you know, we want to have a relationship with Chinese. You speak Chinese. All right? We can't speak Chinese. Why don't you help us? All right? Like a fool, he did, but didn't go very far. But that is precisely what the poison developed. That people say, how come you speak to the top security chief from mainland China in Chinese that we don't know? What have you done, right? So this represents a very interesting development. On one hand, we are the strongest supporter elements in helping American capital development into mainland China. On the other hand, okay, now we are also a liability, right? And this, unfortunately, is going to be very much continue as an issue, right? As you probably know, that the U.S. dollar is going to fall through the floor, and who's going to blame? China is going to be blamed. But the American pattern is they don't just blame China. They're going to blame the people who are of Chinese descent, just like they blame the Japanese descent. So we're confronting a very interesting phenomenon. On the one hand, we are moving out some of the old issues that we were trapped with. On the other hand, we go back to an old thing. That is, Americans don't trust us. The reason they don't trust us is because they don't trust China. Right? And so, anyway, let me just leave it to this and for some questions. Yes?
I put pieces of information into this pot, which everything you say I agree with. I have never said that in my life. Everything you say I agree with.
You said that to your wife?
We'll go into that one later.
You don't dare to say it.
Actually, I do. 2 points. First, you're aware that IBM just sold their PC manufacturing to Lenovo. Lenovo is going to be basically basing themselves in South Carolina to carry that out. Second, of course, is the formation, eventually the beginning of the formation of a common market type of thing in East Asia with a total population estimated around 2 billion, a large consumer base. Which of these do you see as playing the stronger role, and which of these do you think is likely to exacerbate the phenomena that you described at the end?
Well, the first role you're suggesting is playing the role that Japan had played. Japan basically saying, hey, look, don't bitch about, we got money, we invest in your own territory and create jobs. Right? And Japan has done that. China is doing that. China is buying U.S. treasury bonds, exactly what Japan did, so try to cool off some of the criticisms. Now, China, however, has a lot more options than Japan did not have. Mm-hmm. And one is a huge, huge domestic base.
Yep.
And that domestic base is in competition. Who is going to get that? Right? So all the American companies trying to get a piece of that action. All right? But Chinese themselves say, hey, why should you get it? All right? So, this goes back to the 1930s, 1940s, Commodore bourgeoisie, all that discussions. But anyway, but I have been in Southeast Asia a couple years ago, and you could see that Chinese manufacturing skills, Chinese manufacturing capability is penetrating all those places. In Indonesia, for instance, everybody drives a motorcycle, drive you crazy, right? And what kind of motorcycles they have? Chinese made, right? I said, why you Japanese, they cheap. What? No, Chinese are cheaper. I said, are they well made? I said, no, but repair is cheap. So, but in any event, I'm saying that China does have a very, very interesting approach in terms of trying to diversify their markets, and that is going to be a contention too. That's going to be touching on the nerve of Japan as well as the United States. But I think that's very much going on. I was reading on border. You just can't imagine the kind of trade that's going on in Southeast Asia. Yep. Kunming, as you probably visit, Kunming now is the heart of this whole regional economic development. So, anyway, that's the logic of capitalism, and this is how it would play. Yes?
I have a question about, you seem to be sometimes glossing over the differences between Taiwan, or whatever you call it, and the mainland China, as if it's all one happy family or something, and I guess I'm just wondering about, how that plays out in terms of different forces. Not everybody has connections to mainland China. Some people do, to Taiwan. I guess you do. And I just wonder.
I don't because.
I don't know. I heard you say that.
So anyway,
I just wonder what you think of
this
that.
Is an issue, right? Certain people want to talk about. The two kinds of people like to talk about Taiwan and China tension. One is Cold Warriors. All right. Still can't forget this whole thing, all right? Cold Warrior in the United States, Cold Warrior in mainland China. They talk about, a senior officer says, before I die, I want to see China united, all right? You have these Cold Warriors in Taiwan as well. But what's the objective reality? These two economies totally interlocked, right? Economically, total interlocked. You could do whatever you want to do. Ultimately, the issue is, in Taiwan, you want to be independent? Fine. You want to have an economic collapse? Right? it's the same way from the other side. So I would try to, I'm not saying there is no division. I'm saying the division has to be moderated by the overwhelming economic factors, all right? And, you know, there's no businessman in Taiwan talk about, you know, this. They try to cut it. They try to make, somehow try to cut through so they could have direct flight, direct trade, and mainland China, young generation, they could care less about this issue, all right? And, of course, United States has a different interest in this and would like to use this as a political weapon. So, anyway, anybody else?
I have some questions actually about the statistics. Talking about
that's my weakest point, by the way.
about the income of Chinese, say 25% higher than the whites, and that is very surprising.
You don't know this? 1970s. 1970s, we are already. Betty knows. 1970s already. Chinese American average income is higher than whites. We are not. That's. Well, remember what the statistic was? 5 or 6%. Not very. Yeah. So.
Talk about family. I mean,
family medium income. See, this is where, Tom, don't get locked into this thing about whether we made it or not. Okay. Years ago, I wrote a piece. I guess it's about after your thing came out, and you know this model minority thing was very hot. You know, Asians doing so well. So I wrote a piece. Many people, you know, it's nothing original. Basically saying, well, you know, they're not really that rich, because they're a larger family, more people participate in income, right? That's one. Secondly, is Asians tend to be living the high wage area, so therefore reflecting. But look, after 20 years of talking about this, you got to get off this. You got to recognize, insofar as income is concerned, all right, all Asian groups, with the exception of Southeast Asians, refugee groups, are higher. Indians even higher, right? Indians the highest. So 25%, the New Jersey